So the first question is to Dr. Kelly Leach. You've talked about values of immigrants we welcome to Canada, but I haven't heard about the number of immigrants you think we should bring each year. Do you think we need more, less, the same as what we do today, 300,000 or so?
Thank you very much for the question, whoever provided it. What I've talked about is a common sense plan to interview every immigrant, refugee, and visitor to Canada. Obviously, that will have an impact on the immigration process and the system. As Dr. Sachiewicz from McMaster University has talked about, it will slow down the system. But I'm not focused on a quota. I'm not focused on a number. I'm focused on making sure we meet the requirements of the Immigration Refugee Protection Act, which is building our country. That means interviewing every person that comes to Canada. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so I apologize, but...
Do I get to say more?
No, sorry. That was very good.
She's a teacher.
I think what we have to work out is, there's one person, Sophie, you have a mic, so rather than running it down to the stage, I think you can stay to the side, and you can identify, actually if you identify which card it is, whether it's a time card or a rebuttal card, if there's one or two, then I will say the name of the candidate. So the first one, I believe, is a time card.
Yeah.
Chris Alexander, 30 seconds.
Sorry.
I disagree with the idea of interviews for every visitor, for every tourist, for every immigrant, for every refugee. It would cost us a fortune, more than double the budget of this department. It would be bureaucratic. It would be inefficient. It would cost us jobs and business, people coming to this country to spend their money as tourists, as students, to do business here. We would lose a competitive advantage. And we would be giving everyone who goes into one of these interviews, and the small number of those people who are bad people who we want to keep out, simply another opportunity to lie to us. Interviews don't work on that universal basis. They should work on a selective basis. We did use them well under the Harper government, and I have to tell you that after 10 years of Jason Kenney, Stephen Harper, and myself in the position of immigration, we have a system of screening that is second to none. How do we protect our values? By continuing to reform that system, select people responsibly, protect ourselves, and by joining the fight to protect our values against terrorism, to ensure Vladimir Putin is no longer a threat to Ukraine. It's out there that we protect Canadian values.
Okay, I apologize for this delay. I'm going to just quickly review the rules because I think we have an assistant, but this hasn't been completely worked out. So if you can allow me this discretion. So each candidate will be given 1 2-minute talk card. So that's what we heard. So Chris Alexander should have had 2 minutes for the talk card. Oh, I see. And 2 1-minute talk cards. So there's 1 2-minute talk card and 2 1-minute, 1 2-minute talk card and 2 1-minute talk card, and then 4 15-second rebuttal cards, which could be used 2 at a time if you wanted. So I see Steve Schaefer. And Steve, perhaps you could take the mic and assist with Sophie.
You guys wanna...
So I think I put in a 1 minute next. Is that fair?
Thank you. Aaron O'Toole.
Okay, thank you. Friends, this is a political race, so we shouldn't be surprised there's some politics in it. In the last year, the only MP on the stage that asked questions in the House and Committee on screening of refugees was me. Why you may not know that? Because I asked the question respectfully and focused on our security. And you know what? Every refugee family, including those here in Langley, were screened. So let's not pretend that they weren't. My plan, which I talked about in the first debate, is an immigration policy based on three S's. Security, that has to be an absolute fundamental, and it is in Canada. Skills-based, so we need some family reunification, but we've got to fill holes in our economy with new people. It's good for the economy. It's good for those families, because they have opportunity when they get here. And three, numbers should be stable. We shouldn't spike up high numbers like Mr. Trudeau tried to do and rush the system. We shouldn't also drop, and the Harper government did not drop numbers during a recession, because properly done, immigration is a success for our economy, and let's talk proactively about it.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. I will use my minute. So I believe that in the short term, we should reduce the number of immigrants, especially refugees, because Justin Trudeau has gone too fast and is using refugees for political purposes. But in the end, they don't have a job. They have a hard time to learn French in Quebec, and we are not ensured that we have the resources to fully integrate them. We need to work with provinces, municipalities, set those targets. It's not Ottawa's knows the best. The second thing is we have nothing to hide as Canadian, nor those who enter here. So this is a private member's bill I tabled in 2011, and it's called an act to amend the Canada election, voting with an uncovered face. They've asked women wearing the niqab, do you agree with that? They say yes, because when we take a passport picture or a driver's license, we do it. We are proud to be Canadian, and we need to cherish our Canadian identity. See, I'm done.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's be clear. The way that this party handled the immigration file cost us the election. The perception that we had that we were uncaring, the way that the response and the way that some of the attitudes that were portrayed by some of the politicians on the stage here were a big factor in how it cost the election. So I need to tell you one thing. As a son of an RCMP officer and somebody who visits the Canada Border and Security Agents here in Vancouver, I can tell you that we need protection for our frontline people who are out there facing the threats that are coming in. I totally agree with Aaron O'Toole. I think that the previous government did a good job in most of it, but I think that the people up here, many of them who are sitting right here, did not do a good job in the election of portraying the value that we have, the value that we place in our immigration system. My economic plan is the only one that produces the revenue needed to give money to our Canada Border Security Agents and to the RCMP. And you should all Google Jason Kennedy's last remarks on the House of Commons. Canada has been built by immigrants. 20 years from now, half of the people in this country will be immigrants. Let's make this. Thank you.
Maxime Bernier, 15 seconds to vote.
Yeah, the question was how much new Canadians we want to welcome. For me, it's very simple. I want to do what the upper government did, an average of 270,000 new Canadians, not like Justin Trudeau, because like that we won't be able to integrate new Canadians, and I want to have more economic immigrants, and that's it, because for us, the most important is the integration of new Canadians. Thank you.
Kelly Leach, 1 minute.
Let's be very clear. I'm talking about a common sense plan of exactly what our governments did in this nation prior to 2002. What I'm talking about is who we are as a people and what our Canadian values are. And I want every individual who's coming to this country to also agree with them. They're in our Constitution. We have a Canadian way. Men and women are equal. Violence and misogyny are not Canadian values. Hate crimes are not Canadian values. I want you to stand with me for this common sense policy that's going to help build our nation.
Michael Chamorro, 1 minute.
We go into the next election campaigning against a Trudeau on immigration. We are not going to win these seats. We have to quit playing politics with the immigration policies of the government. Do you know who let in a record number of immigrants and refugees in the 10 years that they were in government? A record, a 50-year record, post-war record, Stephen Harper. The government of Conservative Prime Minister Stephen Harper admitted 3 million immigrants and refugees during the 10 years it was in power. Every single one of them was screened for criminality, for war crimes, for health and economic reasons. And that screening remains in place. We've got to quit focusing and playing politics on the immigration file, and instead, we've got to take on the Liberals on economic files, on job creation, and on economic prosperity. That's the recipe to win in 2019.
Okay, thank you, everyone. We have a good system figured out now. What will happen is after the first speaker, who answers answers the question that is directed to them. The others, if you wish to speak, you can just signal. And when you come to the front of the stage with your card, Sophie can take your card at that time, and we will go proceed in that way. So our second question is to Pierre Lemieux.
We have one more, Chris Alexander.
Oh, I'm sorry, Chris Alexander. 1 minute.
Kelly's plan is not going to work. The misogynist, the people who are interested in committing hate crimes here, will lie in the interview, and we will not be any further ahead. I also don't know what questions are we going to ask that summarize Canadian values. How are you going to do that in half an hour or an hour? We have Canadian values in this country. We stand for the Canadian values in this country, and it's called the rule of law. It's called the criminal code. And we measure the behavior of permanent residents and of citizens on the basis of their ability to obey the laws of this country. That's what they commit to in the oath. And if they cross the line, if they commit crimes, if they are convicted of crimes, they are out of here.
The next question is for Pierre Lemieux. And you can choose to use whichever card to answer this question, whether 1 minute or 2 minutes.
Oh, that's what that was?
Yes.
So it's not an introduction, it's how long I
want to
respond.
Well, I'll ask the question, you can make that determination. We have two actually. No, that's not true, I'm sorry. Okay, we're working this out, thank you.
1 minute to respond, and then introduction.
Okay, I better take my teacher hat off and just follow the instructions. We have two submarines that are barely seaworthy and a fleet that is outdated and falling apart. We have few supply ships, sometimes paying foreign countries to supply our own ships. Will you do anything to improve and build up our Navy so that we are respected during international conflicts and are able to defend our nation properly?
Thank you very much. A great question. As I mentioned in my opening remarks, I served in our Canadian Armed Forces for 20 years, having joined at the age of 17. One of the pillars of my campaign is security, which touches on the military and it touches on immigration and security concerns that Canadians have. I am fully committed to our men and women in uniform. I served with them for 20 years, and I've released a policy statement that sees us increasing our spending over time up to the 2% target that NATO countries should be achieving. We're at less than 1% right now. We need to focus on equipping our men and women in uniform properly and in making sure that we have the right numbers of men and women in uniform. I served in the 1990s during that liberal decade of darkness, and it was awful. I was on the maintenance side of Army. We had to maintain all of the equipment, and it was rusting out underneath us. That will not happen under my leadership. Thank you.
Aaron O'Toole, 2 minutes.
The military guy has to use 2 minutes for this one, right? So I'll give that to you. I agree with Pierre. He served as well as I did. We probably have some veterans in the room. We need to give our men and women who serve us the tools to do the job. And I'm fortunate, as a Sea King aviator, I sailed with our Navy on the other coast. And I like to joke, but we all remember Jean Chrétien canceled the Sea King helicopter. He said, zero helicopter, remember? It cost us $500 million and we still needed a helicopter. And it's taken a generation to fix that mistake. Wasted money, lives at risk, and not giving our men and women what they need. I like to joke that if I wasn't a conservative before I flew on the Sea King helicopter, I certainly was after. So my plan is very detailed. The true North, strong and free. And that means as a founding country in NATO, we should all be embarrassed that in the last generation, my entire lifetime, we have not made the 2% commitment we pledged. And now we see President Trump questioning NATO because of all the free-riding countries like us. So I said we will make that commitment. And where will we spend strategically? In the North. We'll bring back the reserves to Yukon, which were taken away by Pierre Trudeau. We'll finish the naval port in Nunavut. Express our sovereignty in the Arctic because the Russians don't appreciate our claim to our territory. I'll rebuild the Canadian Armed Forces reserves, their armories in the communities of the country, their training facilities from coast to coast, so that regiments like the Seaforth Highlanders and the BC Regiment will have the tools they need. And I want us to be a NATO leader in cyber warfare and cybersecurity. Why? Because that's the war of the future. And if we do this, high-tech jobs, engineers, students from UBC, from Waterloo in my province, will have opportunities with that government investment and the trickle over into the economy. So we need to make our international commitments, and an O'Toole government will do that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Stephen Wendy, 1 minute.
Wow, Irene, and wow, Pierre, I couldn't agree more. And I want to say sometimes I disagree, but I fully agree with Pierre and Irene who served our forces. Yesterday, you know the St. Lawrence River on the other side? You know Rio Tinto, they are an aluminum plant. Well, a boat was caught in the ice. Why? Because the Coast Guard was not able to break the ice in the St. Lawrence River. This is Canada, my friend, in 2016. We need to reinvest massively to make sure that we are walking the talk of our sovereignty, especially when our American neighbor is saying, look, you talk defense, well, walk defense. So I fully agree with what you're moving forward, and we need to go on by investing, and I will be giving my defense strategy this Tuesday here in Toronto. Thank you.
Lisa Ray. Sorry, Lisa, is that 1 minute?
Thank you very much. One of the cooler jobs that I had in the private sector was I was actually a harbor master. I was in charge of the ships coming in and out of the Toronto Port Authority. So I'm very grateful for the Navy and their work. Other aspects of my life, though, have been about building projects and delivering on them. So at the Port Authority, I built a ferry, I built a Rochester-Toronto ferry terminal, I built an airport, and I got those things done because it's infrastructure that was needed for economic growth. As the Minister of Transport, I was put in charge of the Detroit-Windsor Crossing. That's called the Gordie Howe Bridge. Born to Crown Corporation, got it going. So why do I tell you these things? I am a builder by nature. This is what I've done my entire career. And I know how important it is to deliver to the Canadian military what they need. And as Prime Minister, I would make myself the Minister of Military Procurement, because the buck would stop with me.
Thank you. We have Andrew Saxton with a...
30 seconds,
thank you.
As Prime Minister of Canada, I will make sure that our Navy gets the ships that it needs so that we can be proud again of our Navy. And a lot of those ships will be built right here in North Vancouver at Vancouver Shipyards. That's a promise. Thousands of jobs as a result. I will also make sure that our men and women in uniform have the resources they need to protect themselves and to succeed in their missions. And when they come home, they will have the support that they need to heal their wounds, both their physical wounds as well as their mental and emotional wounds. We have to look after our veterans. We have to look after our men and women when they come back from conflict areas.
Chris Alexander, 30 seconds.
I saw firsthand over 6 years in Afghanistan what a difference the best armed forces, the best small army in the world can make when you send it on a mission where we are needed. And I agree with my colleagues' proposals, I agree with Aaron's plan, but we need to do more. Larger AVs on both coasts, amphibious assault vessels for both coasts, an Arctic fleet, for that incredible landmass and maritime area that is ours, the best fighter jet, and a slightly larger army.
Thank you, Michael Chong. 1 minute.
I agree with all my colleagues here on stage. The need to increase defense investments, and here's why. I'm literally in front of you here today as a Canadian because of the sacrifices of veterans in two theaters of war during World War II. My father was a Chinese immigrant from Hong Kong. My mom was a Dutch immigrant from the Netherlands. My father watched as Canadian soldiers bravely defended Hong Kongers from a pretty vicious assault in the early part of that war. My mother's family was liberated by Canadian soldiers, some 6,000 of them who died in the canals, the fields, and the small towns and villages of the Netherlands. My family owes everything to this country and the veterans who laid down their lives so that vulnerable persons around the globe, like my mother and my father, could live and contribute to this country. I'm in this leadership race because I believe in this country and the values for which it stands for, and that's why I need your support. Thank you very much.
Kelly Leach, 15 seconds. Sorry. So 30 second rebuttal, Sophie. 1 minute card from Mr. Chung, please. Yes, go ahead.
How many of you in this audience are a veteran, know a veteran, or are serving in the Canadian Armed Forces? Thank you for your service. My grandfather was Army, my two great uncles were on the beach on D-Day. I'm committed to the 2% increase for NATO. I'm also committed to making sure that we focus on Arctic sovereignty. I stood in Afghanistan in 2010 as a surgeon and realized that our men and women in uniform are the ones that are on the front line of protecting our nation and what we represent to the world. They are the first defenders of our open democracy. And again, for those of you that have served, for those of you that are serving, thank you so much for your contribution to this amazing country.
Thank you. Our next question is for Rick Peterson. The roles and responsibilities of the three branches of government, legislative, executive, and judicial, have increasingly become blurred. Too often, legislative bills have been negated, delayed, or overturned by a judiciary that is increasingly swayed by special interest groups in preference to elected MP legislation. How will you restore the constitutional balance?
Whoa. I think the question here is one about the power that you give the members of Parliament. I think the question is one that I think Brad or Pierre touched on earlier on about respecting points of view as leader of the Conservative Party and as Prime Minister. My caucus will be able to bring forward any element, any bill, any concern that they feel needs to be debated, and it will be. As a small businessman, as somebody who is from the private sector, I know that respect from the roots up, from the grass up, is what counts. In terms of the courts of law, one of the elements that I think we have seen over the past several years is the judiciary taking an interpretation of a lot of the laws that are not the way that was intended by the parliamentarians. I have never been a parliamentarian. I absolutely respect the talent and the difficulty it does entail to become a parliamentarian, but I can tell you that we need to give more voice, more votes, and more support to our members of Parliament, and that would be the biggest thing that I would do would be to have my parliamentarians and have their back.
Thank you. Michael Chong, 2 minutes. Starting now.
Thank you for the question. Trudeau has broken his promise on electoral reform. And if we're going to win against the Liberals in 2019, we have to come forward with robust economic policies, of course, but we also have to come forward with a real agenda for democratic reform. There is too much power in party leaders' offices and in the PMO. It's one of the reasons why I'm in this leadership race. I'm the member of Parliament who introduced the Reform Act in the last Parliament, an attempt to rebalance power between an all-too-powerful PMO and your elected members of Parliament, who are your voices in Ottawa. And I think a democratic reform agenda that focuses on the reform of political parties and on reforms in the House of Commons is going to gain the support of millions of Canadians who are disappointed with the Trudeau government's broken promise on electoral reform. To me, reform starts with political parties. Party members, grassroots party members, should make the final decision on who party candidates should be in an election and not head office and not the party leader. Democratic reform also starts with reforms to the House of Commons by rebalancing power and taking power away from the PMO and party leaders. Elected members of Parliament should not have to sit at the whim of the party leader and the PMO on committees. The Prime Minister's office should not be appointing committee chairs. I have a 10-point plan for real democratic reform. You can check it out at chong.ca. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Pierre Lemieux, 1 minute.
1 minute 15.
Right
on. Listen, I'm one of the candidates here that's actually spoken about, I think, a concern that we share, and that is this conflict really between the judiciary and elected members of Parliament. The most controversial issues of our day, abortion, euthanasia, prostitution, they haven't been decided by parliamentarians. They haven't been decided by Canadians. They've been decided by the Supreme Court of Canada. And one of the issues that I have is that the Supreme Court is almost sacrosanct. Like, you're not allowed to breathe a sigh of concern about the Supreme Court of Canada, and I think that's wrong. I also think that you have, and we have as Canadians, absolutely no role to play in the selection of our Supreme Court justices, and yet they are defining Canadian society. You as Canadians have no role to play in their selection. The Prime Minister does that. And they serve to the age of 75. You have no role in terms of being able to do anything about it once they are Supreme Court justices. I'm saying we should have a discussion about this, we should have a debate about this, we should be able to discuss this under freedom of speech in an open and respectful way. Why can't we talk about the Supreme Court and concerns that we have? And so what I put forward in a message I sent to 100,000 Canadians across our country is that perhaps we should have term limits for Supreme Court justices, and maybe we should have politicians helping to decide who our Supreme Court justices are, and you would have a role through MPs in that regard. Thank you very much.
Thank you. The audience refrained from talking. Thank you. Brad Trost, one minute.
Well, let me first of all start by paying my compliments to Mike on his Reform Act and parliamentary stuff. I have very similar views as he does in regards to balancing roles of the Member of Parliament with the leadership. But as Pierre was noting, probably the biggest issue we have is the disproportionate power that the judiciary has taken. And we have a tool if parliamentarians are prepared to use it to take back power for the people. It's called the Notwithstanding Clause, something that was fought for by Conservative and ironically NDP premiers when the Constitution was put in 1982. If we believe a piece of legislation is moral and just, we as legislators should be prepared to back it and take it to the people. That means if the Supreme Court strikes it down, we need to be prepared to use the Notwithstanding Clause to overrule the Supreme Court. We can do that. We just need to take the leadership. I am prepared to take the leadership and use the Notwithstanding Clause regularly.
Thank you. Stephen Blaney, 2 minutes.
Merci. So, one of the great legacy of Stephen Harper's government is to put the victims back at the heart of our criminal justice system.
It will be good for 5 years because we are elected people, and if people like it, well, they will re-elect us, especially in a majority government, if you can, please. So that's how it works. So, I'm glad that during this leadership race, we are talking of identity, we are talking of those issues such as using the notwithstanding clause that politician.
Thank you. Aaron O'Toole with a 30-second rebuttal.
Thank you. As friends, as a lawyer and as a parliamentarian, I believe firmly in the supremacy of parliament. In the last 10 years, courts have legalized marijuana, prostitution, and euthanasia. Fortunately for the first two, there was a Conservative Harper government come up with a framework, including on prostitution, where our caucus and Joy Smith made sure that there were protections for the vulnerable. One of the reasons I voted against euthanasia, the Liberals rushed it through with no regard for Parliament. That would not happen under my Conservative government.
Thank you. Our next question is for Andrew Saxton. If the renegotiation of NAFTA is poor for the Canadian economy, will you think about renegotiating it again?
I tell you, first of all, I will not show my cards before I sit down at the table, like Justin Trudeau did. If you're going into a negotiation, I'm a businessman. Donald Trump is a businessman. I know how to deal with business people. You don't show your cards before you sit down at the table. Canada has a very strong argument here. 35 states in the United States rely on Canada as their number one trading partner. So the United States needs NAFTA as much as Canada needs NAFTA. We had a free trade agreement with the United States before NAFTA even existed. It was the Canada-US free trade agreement. You remember John Turner said he was going to tear it up. Well, thank goodness he did never have that opportunity because it created tens of thousands of jobs for our economy. And also, we have a balance of trade with the United States. This is very different from the United States' relationship with Mexico, where there's a huge trade deficit. And because we have a balanced trade with the United States, Donald Trump will recognize that he needs us as much as we need him. Now, furthermore...
Thank you. Andrew Scheer, 1 minute.
This is such a critical file for Canada. We are a trading nation, and our trading relationship with the United States isn't just about NAFTA. The Americans like to act like they're the Boy Scouts around the world when it comes to free trade, but we know what they do outside of trade negotiations, whether it's country of origin labeling or by American. We need a government that is actively engaged on the ground, not just in Washington, but throughout the country. Donald Trump understands jobs and economics. We need to find those businesses that hire people thanks to Canadian exports, that hire Americans in Pennsylvania and Ohio that rely on Canadian investment and Canadian imports for their jobs. Find those people, bring them to Washington, and make the case for Canadian trade. I don't think that you can win the Trump administration over with appeals to philosophy or being a good neighbor. You have to show that there's economic benefit to both countries for our trade deals, and I know I can do that.
Thank you. Rick Peterson, 2 minutes.
Hi, this is a two-minute response because we are right here today, ladies and gentlemen, with that question at the crux of why we're conservatives and what needs to be done in the next 4 years for this country. Donald Trump will only recognize and understand if we are competitive. If you go to petersonleader.ca, you will see my platform, which has three key components to instilling competitivity and making our country grow. The first one is zero corporate income tax. Already being done in Ireland, already being done in the Baltic states, already being done in Eastern Europe. Donald Trump has just moved the federal corporate income tax rate in the US from 30 down to 15. That's the equivalent of us going to zero. My good friend Maxime Bernier would like to install some energy in the economy going from 15 to 10. I say let's take it to zero. Nobody here who has a corporation or has a business will be paying income tax on a corporate level when I'm prime minister. This money is better used in your pocket to develop new businesses, new investment, hire people, pay salaries, and grow the economy. The second thing is that income tax under a Peterson prime ministership at the federal level for every individual across Canada will be a flat 15%. A flat 15% across the board puts more money in your pocket to invest in Canada and in the future. Under a Peterson leadership and prime minister, consumption taxes will go up because consumption taxes, as every economist knows, as Ed Fast will tell you, are the only and the best way to grow the economy in a way that spreads the wealth. So the final thing that I want to point out to you, ladies and gentlemen, is that negotiating NAFTA with Donald Trump can only be done from a position of strength. Coming from the private sector, understanding the power of liberating the entrepreneurial element that all of us have in it is the key to growth in Canada. Under my leadership, under my programs, Canada will grow and prosper, and we can negotiate with Donald Trump or anybody around the world. Thank you.
30-second rebuttal from Brad Trost.
Yes, seconds. Not so much a rebuttal, but to note that you cannot divorce security issues from economic issues when dealing with the United States. The biggest economic threat to Canada is if another 9/11 terrorist incident happens in the United States and the person comes in from Canada. We need to be absolutely firm and vigilant on our national security when it comes to terrorism, both people domestically and coming from abroad. That is an economic priority. NORAD, our national security, are there not only for security, but to protect our economy. Thank you.
Thank you. Maxime Bernier, 1 minute.
Merci. I'm a blue man, not a white one. So it will be very important to be strong when we will deal with President Trump. And the best way to do it is to be out there in the US and speak with the other business people over there, because the free trade agreement that we had since 25 years now was benefit for our country and also for the Americans. But also, if we want to stay competitive, the most important is to lower our taxes. And I know that President Trump said during the campaign, and I think he will do it, he want to lower the corporate income tax from 30% to 15%. If he's doing that, we won't be able to be competitive. We must do better than that. So it is why I have a plan to reduce the taxes to entrepreneur from 15 to 10, but the most important, I want to abolish capital gains tax in Canada. We'll be the only country in North America without having a capital gains tax, and like that, we'd be more than competitive with the American. Thank you.
Thank you. Aaron O'Toole, 1 minute.
Thank you. The only candidate on this stage that's worked on trade directly in both the private sector and in politics has been me. I was proud to be Ed Fast, Parliamentary Secretary, working on the European trade deal and our important North American relationship. And I was the lawyer in Canada for Procter & Gamble, one of the largest companies based out of Ohio, where Canadian operations were making things and trading them throughout North America and throughout the world. When going to Washington, working with our best friend, biggest trading partner and ally, Americans respect strength because Americans fight for the best for their people. I will take the same approach, fighting for the best outcomes for Canadians and for job creators. And when I went to Washington as a minister, having served alongside the American Navy, when I was in the Canadian Armed Forces, having worked for a global American company, you can go and build a relationship based on mutual respect and fighting for our interests. That is what you all have with an O'Toole government. Thank you.
Thank you. Rick Peterson, 1 minute.
Aaron, also, I was actually born and raised in Alberta earlier on, not from British Columbia, but I'm proud to be from British Columbia, and I would consider my voice to be one from British Columbia. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm a small business person, and I know that for those of you who are employed by small businesses, getting access to money is key for good ideas. How many of you have 25-year-old kids living in your basement who need some money for a startup? How many of you have an idea yourself that you'd love to have access to? Well, I have put forward, if you go to petersonleader.ca, you'll see that I'm the only person that day in and day out works side by side with entrepreneurs. And I have taken the great TFSA account and I've relabeled it the Maple Leaf account. We're going to double the amount of money you can put into a Maple Leaf account. But that money can now go into private enterprises, small businesses of the type that you want to start, your kids want to start. It'll be a place for retirees to shelter more income from their house sales. I'm on the side of you, I'm on the side of entrepreneurs, and I'm going to provide capital for you and us to grow Canada together. Thank you.
Thank you. Kelly Leach, 1 minute.
Yes. The United States is our largest trading partner, 70% of our trade. Hundreds of thousands of Canadian jobs are dependent on our relationship with the Trump administration. Having a respectful relationship with the president also means talking the same language. So whether that be screening immigrants, or whether that means making sure the Keystone Pipeline occurs, I'm from Fort McMurray, Alberta, this is a top priority for me, and I have policy on natural resource development. These are the things to make sure that Canadians come first. So the question was renegotiating NAFTA if we need to? Absolutely. For me, Canadians come first, and I will make sure that that's my top priority as Prime Minister of this country.
Stephen Blaney, 15 yes. seconds.
Thank you. I just want to tell my friends from BC that I will stand up for softwood lumber producer, and I won't cave in like Maxim wants to do by letting subsidized milk coming here in Canada in an industry that is not subsidized and that is creating wealth. Thank you.
Andrew Saxton, 1 minute.
Thank you. In order for us to continue to be competitive with the United States and other countries, we have to help get jobs for young Canadians. The average unemployment rate for young Canadians is double the national average. It's about 14%. We've got thousands of jobs that are going unfilled, yet at the same time, we've got thousands of young people that don't have jobs. We're even bringing in temporary foreign workers from other countries to fill those jobs. I lived in Switzerland. In Switzerland, they have an apprenticeship program for their youth. The majority of young Swiss, they don't go to university, they go into apprenticeship programs. And these are high-paying jobs and professions. It's not just trades, it's also banking, pharmaceutical, insurance, you name it. In Canada, this is what we need. As Prime Minister, I will bring in an apprenticeship program to help get our young people back to work.
Thank you. The next question is for Andrew Scheer. The Trudeau Liberal government killed the legislation for income splitting. Will you support families' right to choose to care for their own children and bring back income splitting?
Well, thank you very much. First, I should probably do a little bit of proactive disclosure. As a father of five children, I benefit very much from family-friendly tax cuts. But that's not the reason why we as Conservatives bring them in. We bring in family-friendly tax cuts because we know the challenges that face parents as they try to raise their children. And there is not one size fits all approach that works. There are families that work opposite shifts so that they can minimize their daycare costs. There are families who have a loved one, an aunt or an uncle or a grandfather or grandmother look after the children. There's a lot of different solutions that are out there. I was very proud to announce what I believe is a very innovative policy to make parental leave, maternity leave and parental leave under the EI system tax-free. Every single civil servant in Ottawa, when they go on mat leave, gets a top-up to 90% or 95%. There's a lot of unionized workers around the country that get that. Non-unionized, non-civil servants don't get that. Making EI, parental, and mat leave tax-free is one way that we can make it more equitable for parents.
Thank you. Maxime Bernier, 15 seconds.
We won't need to bring back income splitting because under my plan, 90% of Canadians will have a flat tax of 15%. So if you have a flat tax, you don't need income splitting, and that's fair for families, and that's fair also for Canadians. So this is the best plan. Thank you.
Thank you. Michael Chong, 30 seconds.
Thank you. I have the same plan as Maxime Bernier does. I plan to introduce a 15% flat tax between $11,000 of income and $140,000 of income. This is in effect a backdoor way to introduce income splitting for all kinds of families. It is also one of the largest income tax cuts in Canadian history, a 1% of GDP income tax cut that we would introduce in our first budget.
Thank you. Andrew Saxton, 15 seconds.
I will bring back income splitting for families because it's only fair. In fact, it's in my plan right here. The road back to balance. Income splitting for families. Why is it fair that one family who earns one amount of money pays a different rate than another family that earns the same amount? It's only fair to have income splitting for families, and I will bring that back.
Thank you. Pierre Lemieux, 30 seconds.
Thank you very much. Oh. Hello? There we go. Okay, so let me just say that as the father of five children, I am a strong supporter of income splitting for families. It doesn't just benefit single income families, but it benefits dual income families where the income is different for each parent. We did this for pensioners. We should do it again for families. And I also want to say as a family man, under my leadership, the party and the government would recognize parents as the first educators of their children. The government should not step between parents and their children. The government does not know best how to raise your children. We need to respect parents with our policies and with our legislation, and you will have that under Pierre Lemieux. Thank you.
Thank you. Rick Peterson, 15 seconds.
I want to thank Maxime and Michael for following my tax plans. They're not quite all the way that I am. 15% for everybody. Zero corporate tax for all corporations. Let's get it done. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is for Brad Trost. Underage drinking and partying has become an epidemic in the Lower Mainland. Kids are dying and are being injured everywhere. What would you do about this awful situation?
You don't need to spend it.
You know, I don't think there's necessarily one automatic solution. I'm a conservative. I don't believe all solutions come from government. But I do think there's a few things that can be done. Steve Blaney's talking about drunk driving legislation. There's educational things you can do from the federal government. But there comes a point where you have to hand responsibility back to parents, to people in the local area. And so for the federal government to change the behavior of children, not going to happen. That's a realistic thing. We can give police more support in areas where they need to crack down, drug enforcement, things of that nature. We can give more educational tools to the specific areas where they're having this problem. But let's be clear. Society needs to solve these problems more than government. As much as I would like to say a Brad Trost government could automatically solve this through some social program or some tax change, it won't happen. It can help in some areas, but it won't ultimately make a solution.
Thank you. The next question is for Chris Alexander. What should Canada do to stem the flow of illegal migrants at uncontrolled border crossings?
First thing we should do is elect another majority Conservative government. What is the main difference between Canada and the United States and the European Union at the moment? We have, or we had, until the Justin Trudeau government came in, a border that works, an asylum system that works, flows of irregular migrants that were minimal, because we worked for 10 years as a team to actually reduce those flows, to reduce fraud, to get rid of citizens of convenience and other phenomena that undermined faith in the whole system. Today, what should we do in the face of a new US administration? We should cooperate. We should explain what has worked in our system. The US does need to get back to a border that works, lower populations of irregular migrants. Europe needs a border. We have an international role to play in taking Canada's model to our key partners and around the world. We are leaders on migration and preventing irregular migration.
Thank you. Stephen Blaney, 15 seconds.
Yeah, I just want to say that I don't like to see our border becoming a strainer with the current government. I would ask right now Prime Minister Trudeau to put 200 more RCMP officers, because we are seeing now an influx of migrants. We need to send a strong signal. Nobody jumps the queue. Thank you.
Thank you. Kelly Leach. 2 minutes. Oh, sorry, 1 minute.
Earlier this week, I was standing in Winnipeg, Manitoba, talking with individuals who were concerned what was happening in Emerson. The newspapers report one or two people. It's literally 40 or 50 people every day. These people are illegally entering our country. We have laws about this. These individuals should be detained. We should talk to them about whether they really are refugees. And if they aren't, they should be sent home. That's what I would do. Enforce the law.
Thank you. Maxime, this is the question from Maxime Bernier. What is your plan to balance the budget without raising taxes?
No, I won't. What I will do, because I just have a question about supply management, and as you know, when Stephen said earlier that the producer under supply management, they don't receive any subsidies from the government, is right. But the guy on the dairy producer, they're receiving subsidies from us, the consumers, and I want to stop that. It's $2.6 billion a year that we're giving to them to keep their privilege. So that's why I want to work for Canadian families. Asking about the question, what I want to do to balance the budget. To balance the budget, we need a plan to have more private investment in Canada first. The first budget would be focused on private investment with lower taxes and also less regulation. But also what we need to do is reform at the federal level. We need to have a smaller government that will respect the Constitution. We need to privatize the airport. We need to privatize Canada Post. We need to abolish the CRTC. We need to reform CBC. So that's all on our platform, maximebernier.com.
Thank you. Lisa Raitt, 1 minute.
Oh, no, she doesn't need it.
1 minute.
Am I okay? Okay, thank you. Max, I appreciate that you want to do the slash and the burn, and I get that, but the reality is that we don't know in the first instance how big the hole is going to be that the Trudeau government is actually going to put us into. So we have to be thoughtful about how we do this. But I do see one thing that's happening, and it's happening a lot, and that is the fact that the departments, three of which I used to manage, have grown immensely in terms of what they are doing in hiring. In Ottawa alone last year, there was 14,000 new jobs created in the federal civil servants. 14,000 jobs, 10.5% higher. The highest it's been since 2009 when we were there. That's the first place where you start. You look at those budgets of the departments and say, are you delivering 14% more services to Canadians? Because I don't think we feel it right now that we are. So that's where you begin.
Thank you. Andrew Saxton, 15 seconds.
My plan to balance the budget is right here. It's called The Road Back to Balance, and it's all on andrewsaxton.ca. Please visit my website. Thank you.
Thank you. Brad Trost, 15 seconds.
Let me offer a helpful suggestion where we can find $1 billion. Get rid of the CBC, privatize it.
Erin O'Toole, 15 seconds.
We need to win the trust back of Canadians. That means a fiscal plan that's achievable. Unfortunately, Max, in 2 years and slashing the tax system to 15%, you can't balance the budget. My plan will get it done in the first mandate while bringing taxes down for all Canadians over time. It's achievable and believable.
Thank you. Maxime Bernier, 15 seconds.
Yes, we can do it. We can save $6 billion a year if we abolish corporate welfare. No more subsidies to Bombardier, no more subsidies to GM, and we'll be able to balance the budget.
Thank you. Andrew Scheer, 15 seconds.
We can do it in 2 years. We have to set ourselves an ambitious target because if we don't, the growth in those departments is organic. I don't know, the people who are ministers up here, did your ADM ever come up to you and say, hey, I found a way we could save money. We can do less. We have to have a firm target of 2 years. We can do it.
Thank you. Michael Chong, 15 seconds.
So a lot of people have been talking about their economic plan. I'm the only candidate here on stage whose economic plan has been reviewed and publicly praised by four Canadian economists. Check it out at chong.ca. It's a real plan. And it's a real plan to get us back on track.
Thank you. Kelly Leach, 2 minutes.
So many of you hear me talk about common sense policies in immigration. I also have a common sense plan on getting us back to budget. It's a 6-point plan. It's been endorsed by the Canadian Taxpayers Federation. It's about capping government spending, making sure that the government of Canada lives within its means, just like you do at home. It's about setting priorities so that you have more money in your pockets, just like you do at home every day. You choose if your child can go to hockey or to soccer. You choose if you're going on vacation or paying off your mortgage. Reducing the debt. Making sure we remove taxes on taxes. Making sure that the public sector benefits and salaries are in line with yours. These are the things that are in my plan. They're outlined on kellyworks.ca. I encourage you to go and look at them. It's a common sense plan to get us back to a balanced budget, reduce our debt, get the waste out of government, and make sure that you, the taxpayers, have more money in your pockets so that you can spend it where you deem fit. Thank you.
Thank you. Andrew Saxton, 2 minutes.
Before we have the opportunity to get back and balance the budget, we have to get reelected as government to bring back fiscal responsibility to Ottawa. And I have a plan to do that. First of all, we have to reconnect with the grassroots. We have to reconnect with the base. You're it. You are the grassroots. We lost touch with the grassroots in the last election, and it didn't do us well. We also have to reach out to young Canadians. We didn't have young Canadians supporting us last time. We have to have a strategy for social media. The strategy that we had in the last election was to stay off social media, and we saw how successful that was. We have to have a plan because young Canadians, they're not reading the newspaper. They're on the internet. That's where they're getting their information from. We also have to reach out to new Canadians and ethnic communities. Jason Kenney did a wonderful job of reaching out to new Canadians. But we lost that. We had them in 2011. That's why we won majority that time. But we lost new Canadians. We lost ethnic communities in 2015. We also didn't win a single seat in the three largest cities in Canada, Toronto, Montreal, and Vancouver. If we're going to take back government in 2019, we have to reach out to people living in the cities, which means that we have to address the issues that are affecting them, like housing affordability, transportation to and from work, and jobs, which is the big one. We also should look at lowering the cost of our membership so we can grow the party so that older seniors on fixed incomes and young Canadians can afford to become members of the Conservative Party of Canada. And we need to invest in technology. Many people in this room have worked on campaigns. How many people have worked on campaigns? A lot of people in this room. And a lot of you are familiar with Sims, right? Well, Sims was state of the art 10 years ago. It was wonderful. But that was 10 years ago. We need to reinvest in a new system to bring us into this new decade. That's what I will do as Prime Minister. I will make sure that we listen to the grassroots, we grow the party in order to win in 2019. Thank you.
Rick Peterson, 15 seconds. 45, thank you.
These are the last 45 seconds, and I want to touch just quickly on two things that are dear to you, your health and the grassroots.
Everybody talks about grassroots engagement. I will deliver, go to petersonleader.ca. Within 12 months of becoming the leader, every single EDA in Canada will have $5,000 to put into their social media platform. Most of these people are MPs, but if you go to their websites, they don't have Facebook, Twitter, or a website active. Check it out. Most final thing I want to say is I'm not a member of parliament, so I don't have MP endorsements, but I do have a very significant endorsement, Dr. Brian Day, who is fighting for more efficient delivery of healthcare. Dr. Day likes my plan. He likes the ability that I want to bring into the healthcare to make it more efficient and easier access for you. PetersonLeader.ca. Thank you. It is a true pleasure and an honor to be here in front of you. Thank you.
Chris Alexander, 15.
To return to balance in 2 years, freeze on spending, freeze on hiring, every program under review immediately. And we have to ask two questions. First, how can we deliver as a digital government? And secondly, how can we invest in frontline people that deliver service and get rid of the layers? There's still too many of them.
Thank you. Stephen Blaney, 15 seconds.
Yeah, I just want to say that I have a Facebook, a Twitter site, but and on the, my website, there's my study that showed the benefit of the great farming and supply sector management. So I'll tweet it after the debate just for you, Scott, and it's available in both French and English. Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, 15 seconds, Aaron O'Toole.
I agree, Rick. Check out my Facebook page, my Twitter. But most importantly, my friend Jim Scott is here. Part of the reason I was able to turn around Veterans Affairs was I was listening and talking to veterans on Facebook, hearing from the grassroots and helping solve problems before the media pounced on them. We've got to be smart. I'm that leader. Thank you.
This is a question from Michael Chong. What will you do to help young Canadians secure employment upon graduation?
Well, thank you. That's a great question. Unemployment in this country is just under 7%. Youth unemployment is double that at nearly 14%. And I think the number one thing we need to do is to get economic growth back on track. And I think that starts by increasing the levels of business investment in this country. One of the reasons why we have lower levels of business investment is because of CMHC's mortgage insurance and securitization program. It is shutting down financing for SMEs in this country and diverting productive capital away from investments into Canadian businesses and rather putting capital toward investments in residential construction. And that has created imbalances in our economy that has negatively affected job creation and the ability of younger people to get jobs. The second thing we need to do is we have to cut income taxes. Personal and corporate income taxes are way too high. I have a plan to introduce one of the largest income tax cuts in Canadian history that would begin in our first budget in the spring of 2020.
Thank you. Stephen Blaney? No. Brad Trost, 1 minute.
We all agree that we need to lower taxes and grow the economy. That's every conservative is up here. But I like an idea that Preston Manning suggested several years ago about looking at starting to change the funding formula for postgraduate education instead of funding institutions, directly fund students, because one of the problems we have is our educational post-secondary system is inefficient at funding people's educations for the job markets. When I've got a university riding, Saskatoon University. The agriculture and engineering students overwhelmingly have job offers. Art students, not so much. Guess which group votes conservative and which group doesn't. We need to find a system that's market-based, that instead of subsidizing institutions, goes directly to students in the post-secondary. It's a reform that has been tried in other places and needs to be looked at here in Canada.
Thank you. Lisa Raitt, 2 minutes.
Thank you very much, Senator. This is the most important question for me because I have two children who are 15 and 12. But let me tell you a little bit about my backstory. I actually found that the best way for me to be able to ensure that I had a sustainable career, unfortunately, meant I'd have to leave Cape Breton. But I did that by getting an education. So I have a bachelor in science, chemistry. I have a master's in science and chemistry, and I have a law degree. But you know what I really got out of all that? A giant student loan. $100,000 that still sits in my mortgage, unfortunately. But it was the price in order for me to be able to have a better life. And I know that going forward, I was able to deal with that debt by getting a job right out of school, and a job that allowed me to pay my debt. So I really want to make sure that children going into the future have that ability too. So here's my solution. Any government of any stripe is going to tell you that we're going to do infrastructure spending. And it's going to be a large amount, because there are many things that we have to ensure we build. Bridges, roads, ports, airports, lots of investments that we can do here in Canada. Big projects. And we've done a great job in the previous government of getting our skilled trades and our apprentices with the help that they need. But we're missing one part of society when we do that. We're missing all of those grads that went to school to do arts or commerce, who did HR or PR or PA or any of those other kinds of fields that are of interest to them. So I would say in any infrastructure project that we would mandate that there would be back office jobs for youth to get that one crucial thing they need to get on the path of their career, and that's skills and training. And I would also encourage the private sector to take on and develop our greatest resource, and that's our human resources, and that's our children. You know, in Cape Breton, we export a lot of resources. The best one, we say, is our human resources. I want to keep our kids in Canada, and those two programs will help us get on that track.
Thank you. Now, before we go to the next responder, there's Andrew Saxton, Andrew Scheer, then Chris Alexander. We actually are down to, yes, we're down to about 7 minutes remaining in this final round. So Andrew Saxton, 1 minute, followed by Andrew Scheer.
Canada is known to be a place where it doesn't matter who you are, what your name is, how long you've lived here, or what you do. If you work hard and persevere, you can achieve financial security for you and your family and create opportunities for your children. I'm concerned that it's becoming more and more difficult for people to achieve this dream for the next generation. I call this the Canadian dream. And when you have a federal government that is taking more and more money out of your paycheck in taxes, and when you have a federal government that is digging us deeper and deeper into debt and mortgaging our children's future, it's becoming more and more difficult for our children to achieve their dreams. As Prime Minister of Canada, I will ask my government every day, what are we doing to help Canadians achieve their dreams? Because that's what we should be doing. Thank you.
Thank you. Andrew Scheer, 1 minute, 2 minutes. Sorry, 1 minute.
Thanks very much. I was born in Ottawa, in Ontario, and moved to Saskatchewan in 2003. I can tell you I was probably one of the only young people that moved to Saskatchewan in that year. And what a difference a change in government can make. Our number one export in 2003 from Saskatchewan was our young people. It wasn't oil and gas or wheat. And now we have a business-friendly government that's lowering taxes, celebrating success, and young people are coming back. So there's a lot of great ideas up here, a lot of innovative proposals. A lot of them will work. We agree on a lot of things. The question is, which of these leadership candidates can convince those young people that weren't voting for us last time to vote for us? Which one of us can take that message and talk about the positive effects of conservative policies to create prosperity and opportunities for young people? Raising payroll taxes will destroy opportunities for young people. That's what the Liberals are promising. Keeping taxes low works. We just need a leader that can go out and convince that broader audience of Canadians.
Thank you. Chris Alexander, 2 minutes.
This, for me, is the most important question of the night. It's on this issue, creating jobs for young people, creating jobs for Canadians, that we will win the next election in 2019. And how do we do it? Yes, by completing our economic union inside Canada. There are a lot of protectionist winds blowing around the world. We need to be strong by setting an example inside Canada. One qualification inside Canada should be good to work anywhere in Canada. Our goods and services should move across the country without friction, without the restrictions on wine, etc. And we need to follow the models that work. Yes, Saskatchewan is one of them. I couldn't agree more, Andrew. And British Columbia is one of them. We need governments that believe in our exports, all of our exports, the oil and gas sector, the mining sector, the agri-food sector, the forestry sector, that get softwood lumber right with the United States. But then we also need to throw those bridges out to new markets. And here I'm talking not just about changes at the margin, I'm talking about doubling, tripling our exports to Europe, to Asia, being aggressive in those markets, investing, in the system that supports trade with those vast parts of the world. That includes defense, yes. And then we need to think about where the economy is going. The new economy, deep tech, advanced manufacturing plus, artificial intelligence, artificial and enhanced and augmented reality, robotics. These are where the jobs of the future are being created in cities like Vancouver, across the Lower Mainland, and across the country. If we are not centers of excellence in all of these fields, we will be letting down the next generation. Technology has been the biggest producer of jobs in this country over the whole time we were in government, 10 years of conservative government. It's only going to become a richer scene for us to mine for job creation in the future if we are prepared to create the incentives for innovation
Thank
to happen
you.
Here in Canada.
Thank you. Pierre Lemieux, 2 minutes.
Thank you very much. We've been talking about how to make the Conservative Party stronger in order to win the 2019 election. And as a leader, I welcome all people to join the Conservative Party, people with different beliefs and backgrounds and faiths, to bring their ideas into the Conservative Party. But I really do want to make an appeal to social conservatives. I raised it during the my opening comments that I'm a social conservative and I stand for things that are social conservative, for example, for life. And I encourage you to join the party and to get people you know to join the party, because how many of us here feel we've been pushed back into our homes, right? And we feel we're fragmented and we feel we have no support, and it's completely untrue. There are millions and millions of Canadians who have the values that we have, and we should be engaged politically on these values, and we should stand for them and not seed up the ground. We oftentimes pull back. And we shouldn't be doing that. We should be standing our ground on the things that matter to us. And I mentioned, for example, on life issues, there are millions of Canadians that believe in the value of life. Why can we not have that discussion in Canada? Why can we not have that discussion within our party or within Parliament? Of course we should be able to do so. And so as leader, I stand for these values, and I say to you as members, reach out to people that you know that share these values, but who might not be here today, might not be involved in the Conservative Party. Get them to join so that the party is a party that hears their voice, and so that the party is a party that represents them. That's how we get a bigger, stronger party. That's how we will defeat the Liberals in 2019. So give these important matters thought. Now is the time to be actively engaged in the Conservative Party and to stand your ground for what it is you believe, and you can do that under my leadership. Thank you.
Thank you. Maxime Bernier, 15 seconds.
I agree with Pierre. I think it is very important to welcome everybody, the pro-life, the pro-choice people in our party, and that's why under my leadership, I want the members of parliament to be able to table a bill on social issues, abortion, anything that they want. They will be free to table that bill. And yes, we'll have a debate and it will be a free vote.
Thank you. Andrew Scheer.
I just want to follow up on that last point. I think that's
30 seconds.
I think it's incredibly important that every kind of conservative feels welcome in this party. And that's what a good leader will do, is find that consensus. A great example of an issue between social conservatives and non-social conservatives was raising the age of consent. That was something that united our party, that social conservatives wanted, that enjoyed broad-based support throughout the country. And I was the speaker who upheld the rights of individual backbench MPs to vote freely and introduce legislation and speak freely in the House of Commons, regardless of what their party whips told them.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, that is actually the final question of this afternoon. And I want to just thank all of our candidates for their incredible energy and the stamina that took you right to the end here. Give them a big round of applause, everyone. And to all of the audience, thank you for your great questions. So we're not quite done. I'm certain that all of you like me can see the depth and breadth of the political and business experience and deep commitment of our leadership candidates, feel the excitement and momentum that is building to the day in May when we will elect our new leader and ultimately our next Prime Minister of Canada in 2019. You've been a great audience, and I know I'm back to Mark, who will introduce our final and very special speaker.
So you may be seated for a moment.
Now, I've seen a number of the debates that have been going on for the last number of months, and I think this was the best leadership debate so far. I also want to thank Yana Martin, our moderator, for an incredible job. And I want to thank each of you for your excellent questions, for being polite, attentive, and listening to this incredible group of people behind us. It is really exciting that we're hearing incredible conservative policies, policies that will bring Canada back into balanced budget and prosperity and jobs and a clean environment and everything that Canadians truly want. And it's exciting to know that one of these people will be the next Prime Minister in Canada. I'm really honored to right now to be able to introduce a very special person that's going to tell us how we do that. How do we vote for this next, for the next Prime Minister? This person is a person that we've heard from these candidates repeatedly over and over again sharing that name, that name of Ed Fast, the name of the Member of Parliament for Abbotsford. I've been honored to call Ed a friend for many years. We served on council together, and we've served in Ottawa together for many years. We've sung together, we've traveled together, and I can assure you, seeing this man in his heart behind the scenes, his love for family, his love of God, his love of music, and he gives 110% for everything he's done. He's been acknowledged over and over again as the hardest working member of parliament, minister of international trade that there's ever been, and created so many deals, trade agreements internationally that have benefited Canada, and the Trudeau government is now benefiting on some of the hard work. And he's an amazing man. He's recently had a challenge, he had a stroke, and he's come back and he's gonna fully recover for that. Would you please join me in welcoming our great friend, Ed Fast.
Can you hold it for me?
Well, thank you so much, everybody. That is so kind. I just wanted to start off by big thank you to my Conservative family. It is so good to get together again as our Conservative family. Wasn't it great? And a big thank you to all of you that have supported me, that encouraged me through this very difficult time, and of course prayed for me. It is an amazing thing to have this Conservative family surround you when times get tough. All the emails you sent, the Facebook messages, the phone calls, the visits at home, it has been unbelievable. So now let's talk about what happened here tonight. It was amazing. Didn't you love the spirit of the debate? It was respectful the way we are as Conservatives. It was vigorous. I love some of the exchanges. Thank you for doing that. Maxime, you started it all. And you know, that's what we do as Conservatives. We debate the issues. We come up with policies that serve Canada well. And I did want to thank all of those EDAs, the four EDAs that put this together. Think of all the work it took to organize this and the volunteers it took. Thank you to the volunteers for the work you did. Folks, we as Conservatives have so much to offer this country. Our goal, of course, is to ensure that we replace the reckless Trudeau government. You've heard about it today on the stage. We have to replace this government that is driving us into the ditch economically and socially. And so what will that take going forward? Most important, we have to elect the right leader. Now, after hearing the debate here, you know, I've served with all of these men, except for one, for quite a number of years. They're immensely competent individuals, and I'm getting to know Rick much better. Every single one of these men and women is thoroughly conservative. We may have different views on specific issues within this conservative spectrum, but each one of them could lead our country. And it's our job, of course, to elect the best one. So what does that what will that look like? If any of these individuals has inspired you, get involved in their campaign. Support them with funding. You know, running elections and running leadership campaigns costs a lot of money. And they have to raise that money individually from you. There's no such thing as corporations donating or unions donating to these campaigns. They've got to raise this money themselves. And as they travel across the country, it is expensive. So I'm pretty sure today, through this debate, you've been inspired by one or more of these individuals. Get involved. But additionally, you need to get your friends and family involved, because the more friends and family you sign up for the party, the more they get a chance to shape the future of this country. We are essentially electing the next Prime Minister of Canada. May 27th is the day. It will be a preferred ballot. It will actually be a ranked ballot, where you'll get a chance to rank all of the candidates in the order of your preference. So I hope you've listened very carefully today to the positions they've taken, to the views they hold. You've had a chance probably to judge a little bit their personalities and their character. It is absolutely critical that we elect the right leader who's going to take on Justin Trudeau and win in 2019. So, friends, as we move forward towards May 27th and the election of our new leader, let's not take this decision lightly. This is a very important decision for our country. And we've been called upon to make that decision, each one of us. Each one of us gets a vote. Let us consider carefully and thoughtfully about who should lead us to take on Justin Trudeau's Liberals in 2019. That choice is ours to make, so let's choose wisely. And now it's my responsibility to bring this whole debate to a close. So I encourage you to get out there, get involved, support these candidates as we move towards electing a new Conservative government in 2019. Drive safely. Thank you, everyone.